I just want to take some time to go over the settings that you should use in Photoworks when you're ready to do your final rendering. Now, these are generally the settings that you're going to want to use after you've, you know, got your scene set up, you've got your materials assigned, your environment defined, your lighting defined, and you're ready to do your final rendering out to a file. And this is when you're ready to wait for the computer as it does a high quality rendering. So let's just go through the different things you want to set before doing this. The first thing you're going to want to look at is actually in the document settings. So under Tools, Options, in Document Properties here, you want to go to Image Quality and set the tessellation high for all your geometry. What this does is it gets rid of those blocky looking edges where it looks like your curved edges are made up of large straight lines. By setting this to a higher tessellation level, it uses more straight lines to simulate curved surfaces, and you'll get nicer looking surfaces. Now, we're in an assembly here, so I actually can't move this slider without checking Apply to All Referenced Part Documents. Now what this is going to do is as I change my tessellation, that's actually going to apply that to each of the part documents that's part of this assembly. If this were just a normal part document that I were editing, this would be grayed out and I'd be able to move this slider. So generally 3/4 of the way up works pretty well, and for most computers, you're going to be able to leave this at a high setting even when you're editing your parts. It's only when parts are extremely large or you're working with extremely large assemblies that this is going to have a significant negative impact on your computer's performance. So we go ahead and set that. The next thing we want to look at are in our Photoworks options. So up to Photoworks options here. One of the most important settings is under Document Properties and the Anti-Aliasing Quality. For most final renderings, you're going to want to set this to very high. And what this does is it samples more pixels than are actually going to be shown in the final image, and it uses that additional information to make very smooth edges and blending between different lines in your final rendering. It's a technique called anti-aliasing. The higher you set this, the longer the rendering is going to take, but it's going to look much nicer, both in terms of your edges and the quality of the materials. So you're going to want to set that to very high. In addition, if you are using indirect illumination, and you're not necessarily always using indirect illumination, now is the time to set it up to maximum here for most realistic. Now, not all renderings warrant or require indirect illumination, but if you do have your lighting set up for indirect illumination, now is the time to change this. We're not using indirect in this particular rendering. So I'll apply that and close it. The next thing we want to check is to make sure that we're using a camera for our scene, and this is for a number of reasons. The camera will provide realistic perspective. You can set the angle of the camera, the view angle of the camera, etc. And it's also going to give you kind of like a bookmarked view where you can, which you can render from again should you need to, and get the exact same view. So you need to define a camera, and once you have that defined, you're going to want to make sure that you are using that camera view. So now we're in this locked view that that is defined by this camera. Also, if you have depth of field set up in your camera, now's the time to turn it on. Normally, when you're doing test renderings, you're not going to want to have depth of field on because it's a very slow process. But for a final rendering, you're definitely going to want it. So we go into our camera properties, and this is when you would turn on depth of field. Not all renderings use depth of field, and in this case it's not even set up properly because my view planes are all back here. But if we did have depth of field set up, this would be the time to turn it on. The last thing we need to look at is the setting for our lights. Now, in particular, we're looking at the quality of the shadows for any lights that do cast shadows. Now, there's two different places this could be set. I know that in this scene, the one light I do have casting shadows is the key light, so let's take a look at that. The shadow settings are set in the Photoworks properties for a light, down under shadows here. Now, if I had, there's three different ways you can define shadows for a light: global, no shadows, and shadows on. If I had shadows on here, then I'd be able to directly edit the edges and edge quality for this light. For this light and this light only right here. In this case, I'm actually using global shadows. And what that means is that any light that's set to global shadows is going to share the same scene-wide settings for the shadows, and that's actually what I've got set here. So assuming you are using global shadows, and I generally recommend doing that because it puts all your shadow settings in one place, you would leave that at global shadows within the particular light, and then we would go to the PhotoWorks scene lighting tab, and this is where our global shadow control is. So here, we're going to want to set the shadows to transparent. The edges, you're almost always going to want these to set these all the way to soft. And then the edge quality, you're going to want to put at least in the middle of the scale here. Now, this is something that really affects processing time. As you go beyond the middle here, you start to get diminishing returns, and this renders to take a lot longer. For most computers, you're going to get acceptable quality speed trade-off at about halfway here. For very fast computers, you might want to go 3/4. I've never really seen it necessary to go all the way to the top here. So make sure it's at least halfway up. So we'll apply that and close it. And now that we're all set up, of course, to do our final rendering, we're going to want to render to file. You're not going to want to render to the screen and then do a screen capture or something like that. So PhotoWorks, render to file. And we'll just do a test render here. Test render. Normally, TIFF is a good, safe format to output to. PNG can be good, especially if you need a quick transparent or a quick rendering that's got a transparent mask on it. But TIFF has a lot of information, and it's going to be easy to use in Photoshop. If you're just doing a rendering straight to a file that you need to just send to someone and you're not going to post-process it in Photoshop or anything, you could even go ahead and use JPEG. If you do use JPEG, you should set it on high image quality here so that it's not compressed too much. In this case, I actually want to use TIFF. And down here, you can set how large your rendering is going to be. So I'm going to do 800 by 600 here. Note that if you don't want this normal screen sized aspect ratio, if you wanted to do a portrait layout or some other aspect ratio, you could uncheck fixed aspect ratio here, and then you could do something like that, for example. In this case, I do 1800 by 600. And so you've got that set up, and you can go ahead and hit render. Now, since we are doing a recorded video here, I'm going to let this go and then fast forward ahead once the rendering is done. And after that amazingly fast rendering, which actually took about 5 minutes on my computer, the file is rendered out. So what I want to do now is switch over to Photoshop and just show one thing here. So I'm going to open up that TIFF. Okay, this is what I've got. Now, it's looking a little dark, actually. And say that, I wasn't able to get exactly the kind of brightness and contrast that I wanted with the lighting itself inside the rendering. Sometimes it's best just to go into Photoshop and adjust that afterwards. The tool that you're going to want to use is not the brightness contrast adjustment tool. You're going to want to use the levels tool to do this. So load your image up into Photoshop. Then you're going to want to go to Image, Adjustments, Levels. Now there's lots of different ways to adjust this sort of thing, but the easiest is to open up this levels tool, and what you're seeing here is a histogram. This is all the dark pixels, this is the light pixels, and this is the total gamut of the distribution between the maximum dark and maximum light. So you can see that most of the pixels, there's a big spike here in the darker area, and then there's some in the mid-range here, and then it's trailing off, you know, it's not even getting two-thirds of the way towards the lightest pixels. So what we want to do is spread that out a little bit. And that's done just by dragging these endpoints in to encompass the whole histogram. So, you know, you get these till they maybe just chop off the very ends of the histogram there. So you can see that brightened it up a bit. It brought out those midtones. I'm just turning on and off the preview here. You can also change the overall gamma of the image, which is sort of like an overall brightness, by moving this middle one. So this kind of just changes the overall brightness of the image. It's changing where the middle of the histogram is going to be. So maybe I want to brighten things up a bit like this, or maybe I want a dark dramatic shot like that. So once you've got that the way you want, you hit OK. And now, you know, just to see the before, this is the after, this is the before. You know, that one little change in Photoshop can help an image a lot. So a lot of times it makes sense to go into Photoshop and adjust the levels to do the final touches on a rendering.